chat with the few people that were on board and not at the meeting. And so we were able to kind of discuss what's going on in Kamloops a little bit, and maybe I have a better feel for what might be interesting for this group. And so the talk I've put together, we can really change this, because it's, you know, there's a lot of different topics that we could examine together. And so I've just put this one together because I am really moving toward nukes a lot more myself. And so I thought, well, let's just focus on this, and let's focus on the spring, because that's where we're at, and people might want to know more about what we're doing in the spring. So with that, let's dive in and see what's going on here. So Bees to Bees, a route to sustainability with the invaluable wintered nuke. So I think the main thing to think about in the spring are, what are your goals? And actually, it's not in the spring, it's the year ahead. You want to do this at least a year ahead. And you want to say to yourself, okay, what do I need to do? Like, how many bees am I losing? Am I losing a high percentage of bees every year? So my sustainability is maybe a little lower. And maybe before I think too much about nukes and things, I just have to hit all the regular things that you need to know, like treatment levels, feed, the type of stock you've got. You've got to tick all those boxes first. And then maybe then you can get into that next level of sustainability through splitting and nuking what you have. But you want to make sure that you're able to keep your bees going. But then having said that, say you're losing 25%. Well, part of that will be is now if you can make up nukes and winter them, and they can provide you with the extra 25% that you don't have to buy packages or other nukes from other people, that gives you sustainability. And that's what we want to build on. That's what we want to make. We want to make sure that you have for yourself bees that work well for you in your area, and you have enough that you can actually sell some to other people, or use them just as queens or substitutes in the spring. So I think sustainability really can heavily rely on these nukes. Now, can you guys see a pointer at all, or should I make it a colored thing?
No, we can see it.
Okay, all right. So that's kind of looking at sustainability. And then maybe you want to increase. So if you want to increase, but you want honey production, we shouldn't be talking about nukes. We should talk about splits, because of course you want something bigger that's going to do something for you in that year. When I'm talking about nukes primarily, I mean, I'll make nukes and I'll actually make honey from them, but I don't think you should assume that you can do that. You might want to instead make bigger, use standard equipment, whatever size equipment you're using, and make that as a split, and then have an extra hive that way. So you have to kind of look at that for your goals. And then, of course, we're hoping that you're going to make all these nukes just after hearing this talk, and that you'll now have nukes for sale in 2023, as well as extra queens if you need them. So there is the idea in the spring that you can make a split, which is a larger unit, or a nuke, which is a smaller unit. And I just want to kind of cover that a little bit. Okay. And what I would also like, if you want to, that you can either post things to the chat, and maybe Ed or Murray or someone can pick up those questions, and you know, at an appropriate time as we're going through. I don't mind taking questions during the talk, right? So this is just a quote from Kirk Webster, who is a beekeeper that doesn't treat at all and hasn't for 20 years. And he winters nukes outside, and he winters mating nukes outside. So that's kind of a unit that's half as small as a normal nuke. So if he can do it, I think we all can winter nukes that are 4, 5, and 6 frames on standard sizes. And then just some of the reasons why he does it. And he's got, if you haven't been to his website, I think it's just full of great philosophy and a lot of good information. It really widens your scope. So there are different times, of course, during the season that you can make up your nukes. But I'm going to really, and so you can make them up in the, oh, there we go. You can make them up in the spring. you know, when things are just bursting with bees and honey and everything's looking deluxe, or you can make them up after your honey flow. But that's a little harder, and I'm not going to concentrate on that today. We're just going to talk about spring because that's where we're at, and there's enough details there, I think, to cover without going into the different types of nukes you can make at when and how later in the season. So we're going to concentrate on the spring nukes. And of course, there's a lot of reasons to make them up besides just having spare queens. You might also just want to do a little swarm control. Here I am with just one in the tree, you know. Our bee inspector has shown up and there were five swarms in the trees. This would be out of a nuke yard. And I tend to let my bees, and I should warn you, I tend to let my bees get robust. I don't like little units. I like big units. I like them fat. And if they swarm, so be it. They will maybe make a community for me of bees that survive out there in the wild. And obviously, I'm okay with that. I mean, not entirely, but I don't look on it as a real negative entirely. Okay. So, oh, and then of course you can equalize for honey flow. So you can just go through your hives and make sure they're all a set size at a certain time in the spring. And then you know that they won't be swarming from then on, and you've culled all this extra boos and bees that you're gonna make your nukes out of. So that's another reason to do these nuke makeups. And so what should they look for? Well, obviously you've let her go a little bit too late here. We've got a lot of capped queen cells, and they might even be hatched here on this frame. And then over here, this one is kind of bursting with bees, but this is kind of the size of unit I like. And in fact, I might have a picture of another one here that, because quite often, because we run these screen bottoms that have a large space before you get to the box, and they'll make a drone comb in that. And so sometimes they will have made quite a bit of drone comb, but no queen cells yet. So I like to have something kind of bursting with bees when I do my splits. And you want to make sure that you don't split them too hard too early, because you can, you know, once you've stressed your bees, it's quite possible that you'll get EFB, chalk brood, things that are developed because you've stressed them from your management. Like you can take, just as an example, you can take a highly hygienic hive and give it a hygienic behavior test. And if you've mismanaged that hive, or it's too small, or you don't have an on-stream age of workers that will do the hygienic behavior, it will not show up as being hygienic at all. So you can really do a lot of damage as a beekeeper as well as help. So just make sure you don't do it too small is what, you know, is what I'd say. And of course, you're going to lose your swarm and your money and half your bees if you let them swarm. And then when is this likely to happen? Well, you guys are probably all pretty experienced, and you pretty well know when you're going to need to make your splits, when things are going to swarm. And could be around dandelions. I guess for us, if we have stimulated our hives with a pollen patty, then we will find that they'll be ready to swarm end of April, first part of May, maybe. So we have to be kind of on it, maybe even this, you know, it depends on the year. I mean, there's a 2-week change in your season quite easily from one year to the next. So it's kind of nice just to do it relative to your flowering plants. And I just keep a spreadsheet for every year. And it has, you know, when all the main things in the spring flower, and I just have the date for that every year. And then I can kind of track what happened, and I'll put on, you know, my winter success, how many nukes I sold, that kind of thing. And it's kind of just that easy way to condense this knowledge that you can look back on over the years. Okay. Yeah, if you see your queen slowing down, that's another good indicator. And of course, they're going to be, you're going to have a lot of drones hatching at this time too, which is, you know, what they need to do to swarm. And if they're beginning to wet their queen cup, so you go in, she hasn't laid the eggs, but those workers have decided that that she needs to lay there. And they put a little film of royal jelly on there, I think it is. And so that's wetting the queen cups. And that's like, you need to do something today to that hive. Okay, so this is more a picture of sometimes how much I'll let them go. So this is all drone brood at the bottom of the single, and but let me say here that not everyone would let bees go to this extent before doing their splits or divides, and I like a chunky. I like a nice solid set of brood with the honey coming in, and here's your drone brood. And it's some of it's hatched already and it's capped and so on. So this is a unit that's doing fairly well. Okay. So there's a ton of ways that you can make splits. And you probably know most of this yourself. There's the topper or the walkaway split where you, we'll go into each one of these in a minute, or you can break out your hives completely. Or you can nuke the nukes. And this is something I think that we've been learning how to do the last few years. I mean, we've done it for a lot of years, but we've really ironed out the details and it's really picked up, and we're doing it much more efficiently now that we're using the Michael Palmer double nuke box and using that as part of our routine. And we'll go into that a bit later. So of course, the walkaway split is you've got all regular equipment, which is such a bonus. And you just put this extra box for the walkaway above the queen excluder. And then you take any frames that you have of extra brood and honey that you say you're kind of equalizing your hives at that time of the year, and anything extra, you just shake them back into your hive and then put them over in a deep box or shallow, if that's what you're running, above a queen excluder. And let those bees come up from below overnight or even during the day and come back that evening, and then just take that box away. So you don't have to find the queen, and you've taken everything that you want to take away from it. So that's probably one of the easiest ways to make a split. So I think I've covered those points. And you'll put empty cones back in the brood box that you've taken frames out of, how much. And then there's always the question of how much to take away. Well, we used to pollinate in cranberries. And so they would go down near the end of May, early June. And so we would go through the whole operation and make sure that everything was about 6 frames of brood. Because that when that hatches, that's going to cover double that amount of, so you've got the one box that's going to just burst into that second box if you've got that 5 to 6 frames of brood there. Okay, went the wrong way. Okay, and then the other method other than the walk away, which is what we would do in the past quite a bit, is we just go into a yard where say we had older queens or something in the spring and just wipe it out. We just nuke it out. And the thing about spring nukes, this wouldn't be so much for splits, I think. Splits, you'd probably want to do a walk away. But when you wipe out a yard, you've made a lot. So say you have, 20 hives in a yard, you probably can get 80 to 100 nukes out of it. So, it's a very efficient way to suddenly get a lot of nukes. So that's another way. But the way that we're doing it now, and we love it, is we're nuking our nukes. So what do we use? Well, we use a 5-frame nuke box, but 4s have worked for us. We've wintered 4s quite nicely. 6s work beautifully as well. It just, we happen to go with the 5. It works well for us, and so we've continued using it. But the big, huge thing that's been different for us is having the bottom of the nuke box separate now, that it can come off from the box. And this has allowed us to do so much more efficient splitting, assessing, just everything we wanted. Well, honey production, of course, you can take that extra box and just pop it on top or a third or fourth box. And it's a virtual hive, much lighter. And now you've got well, got a lot more queen power working for you too. But let's go into a couple details here as well. I guess one of the things we use and we really quite like it is this bit of plastic. So it's a black and white plastic I think they use in greenhouses. And we just buy it from our local grow up person, basically. And basically we like to have it so that one side of the plastic will go down the side of the box and the other side of the plastic will be folded over underneath the lid. And this rim, we only have that on for just a little bit of the year, really, just here in the spring when we've got our palm patties on, just gives us that extra space to put our patty on. And why this little bit of plastic is important to us is for several reasons. Well, there's a lot of good reasons for using this thing. One is the fact that when it goes down the side here, where's my pointer? There it is. When it goes down the side here, it'll make sure when these boxes are sitting one next to the other, that the bees aren't going to be able to go from one unit to the next. And we happen to not mention this or exaggerate it enough when we were telling a beekeeper about how he did this. And he had four nukes in a row, and that next spring he had one nuke, and it was really big because those bees had just moved right over into the one nuke, and that's the queen they preferred, and that's what they were going to do. And so this also helps, you know, if your equipment isn't really even at the top, but I must say that we use Greg Kesey, yeah. He builds most of our equipment for us now, and he does a very good job at a fairly good price. And so we don't have much of a problem with that because he's so precise in the way he builds things. So yeah, so this is the separate bottom box, inner cover and rim. Okay. And then the other thing we do is we do keep track of our queens and our queen cells. So we'll say when we made the nuke up on the front, and it's just a little white card, and we use a 9mm really soft lead pencil on this thing, and it'll last for years, but you don't really need it. And it'll just say like yellow, green dot, yellow dot, white dot, if it's dotted or not, and the line. And we've learned quite a bit from this because certain lines of bees might be more susceptible to this or to that, or be better honey producers or whatever. And so if you are doing a fair number of nukes, I would suggest you do track your lines and you'll learn a lot. So this picture is just thrown in. I probably should throw it in later on because there's a lot of things that are done here that you don't want to do. And there's a few that you do want to do. So what's wrong with this setup? Let's point that out right now. Well, the first thing is you've got a nuke and a nuke here. And you've got a little bit of foil here. So we often use, you know, that insulatory bubble wrap that's got the foil on one or two sides. We'll use it for all kinds of things. And of course, you could use that probably for this inner cover, like quite a few of the more northerly beekeepers are beginning to do that. They use the bubble wrap because the radiant energy bounces off that foil and goes back into your units. We use it around the periphery, as you'll see in a minute, but not as the inner cover. But the other thing that's kind of not good here is that we prefer to have these nukes so that they're facing opposite directions if they're stacked in a row. And that just precludes a lot of drift. So I would suggest that this setup where the entrances are both on the same side, that's not what you want to do. So there's a zillion reasons to do nukes. And this is just the first slide to say why you'd want to. For me, I don't like lifting deep, heavy boxes full of honey anymore. So a 5-frame nuke suits me just fine. You've got plenty of room to winter, and they winter really, really, really successfully. As we've talked about, they can be your insurance against winter losses, and they should be. They could be added to queenless hives. And of course, if you do it very successfully, you've got some extra income now too. Not only that, but so going into winter, they're gonna be less expensive to feed and to treat, and they're gonna be much more efficient to treat. So that, for a hive you've got, or you used to use, because I don't think, well, fewer and fewer people using that apiifier, but used to use, say, 2 to 4 strips if there's a single or a double brood chambered hive. Well, in a nuc, at the most, you'd use 1 strip. And yet that unit would build up to a honey producer, no problem for you. So anyway, there you go. And for us, we also, it helped gives us a preliminary test for the queen. So say we winter about 1500 nucs or something like that, and we're gonna go through and we're gonna split those in the spring. So we're gonna go through all of those units and we're gonna pick out the top 10% of those and use those. So it's kind of like a pre-grading system, if you want, because we nuke the nucs now. And of course, you've been able now to take locally. Going to have this broad base that you can build on of queens and a stock that will just help you be more successful year after year. Okay, so how do we do this? I guess what we like to use pollen patty ourselves. We make up our own generally, but I will use global as well. I usually make up about half these days. I'll make with my daughter and son, who are also both in business. We'll make up our own patty, and you can see here we don't scrimp. This is probably about 2 pounds of patty that we'll put on. So that would be over the 1.5 pound global large patty that you buy, okay? And how we gauge it, I'll go into this later, but I might as well tell you here now that we'll just cover the amount of bees that come up, we will cover with pollen patty is how we do it. That's how we gauge it. And when do we put it on? Well, we like to put it on 2 to 3 weeks before we feel there's going to be a natural good pollen flow. So as an example, if you're in the South Okanagan, so you guys would probably be the equivalent of Vernon, would you? Or what area of the Okanagan are you guys equivalent to? Murray, have you, or Ed?
Vernon Armstrong.
Vernon Armstrong? Okay. Yes. Okay. So for that, we would put the pollen patty on because our daughter is, of course, in Armstrong, and she would put her patty on probably the first week of March then. So that's when she'd do that. And then so that 2 to 3 weeks later, you now have 2 to 3 frames of cat brood are ready to go. And how do we do that? Well, we do it by the shared warmth. That's what our theory is. This seems to work for us, and this is why we think maybe it does, is because we've got these nucs and they've set up and they're tight to each other. In fact, as my daughter says, make sure they're cozy. So she gets 2 big guys at either end of her row and they just push and they just make these things are just bloody tight to each other. And you can put a hand down between those at any time of the year, and they're toasty warm. One of the things you want to be sure and do if you can is when you're making them up or putting them together in the fall is that you make sure you don't have any kind of half-size nucs or really small ones, because they'll just be a cold sink, right? I mean, you can put that between 2 much larger ones if you want. They'll probably overwinter, but just to keep that in mind. So we've got this shared warmth, this coziness going for us. And we also like to use, we used to use just 1-inch styrol, and that was great. And we just used it on the top, and that was pretty good. But then we threw some on the bottom, and we realized, hey, we got an extra 2 inches of brood now, all the way down to the bottom bar on the equivalent units that now have the styrol on the bottom. And then we decided, what's with the 1-inch? I mean, another $15, and we can winter 9 more nucs twice as well. So now we use the 2-inch insulation on the top and the bottom. We just wrap it round with this foil bubble wrap, and that's just stapled on, and it's mainly a radiant energy so that it makes it go back into the unit. It equilibrates. So I've been doing a little bit of work with the Broodminder T2 sensors and nucs, and I experimented. I had some nukes that were, they had the foil just to the back and nothing on the front. And then some were wrapped around with tar paper. And then some were wrapped around with this bubble wrap with the foil. And basically the foil wrapped ones did the best for sure. The ones that had no insulation at all to the front, so they were getting that full radiant sun energy. And they did, the temperatures went way up during the day, but at night they would again go much lower than those that were wrapped in the foil. So that was kind of a learning exercise. And then the other thing that we do is we use these Boardman feeders. And that way we can keep these things cozy and tight. We're not putting a bucket of feed on top. And I should say now and reiterate again later that we don't feed in the winter. A nuke, this five-frame nuke, when it's ready to go into winter, will weigh 45 pounds plus. So it's well fed. And they have no need for any feed at all if you have a stock that winters well. In fact, you'll come through with a lot of honey. But that honey will go really fast as soon as you put this pollen patty on, because they'll start to brood. And when they start brooding, that's when they're going to use their honey in general. Okay.
There is a couple questions there. Do you want them now or later?
Oh, sure. Let's do it now.
You want to read them, Mikkel? Or?
Sure. Yeah. You kind of explain it here. I just seeing here in the picture. I was first asking to see when you store a five-frame nuke, is it as a single or do you have multiple stacked on each other? As far as I can see here, it looks like it's single. And right. and I presume they also look like their five-frame nukes are deep frames, right? It's a deep one.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. Another question I had when you are assembling, because how you said when you're doing the splits and all that, when you're assembling the five-frame nukes, do you normally put in queen cells, like so they're like mating nuke, or do you actually putting in mated queens?
Okay, those are great questions. And that I will answer just a little later, and I think maybe the next slide or something. But thank you for reminding me to talk about the double hive versus the single hive and wintering those. Because that's a very important point for a lot of reasons. What I have found now is that if you winter these single hive ones, they're going to be treated much more efficiently than your double hive ones, depending on how you treat. And the other thing that you have to keep in mind too is queen power. So if you've got these single hive units, for the amount of bees, like you're going to have probably a box and a half of bees in these guys, maybe even two boxes of bees if they're really chunky, nice units. But you only have that one queen, right? Whereas over here, you've got the equivalent bees, but you've got the two queens. You've got a queen working for you, double the queen power, basically, right? So your single box one is more efficient to treat. It's got double queen power and maybe a little more potential, as you'll see in a minute. But why I do winter the double hives, if you're wondering why I do that, is because for a couple of reasons. One is I got too lazy to do the splits later in the year. So I just ended up with way too many double hive units. And secondarily, we use these double hive units for rearing queens and queen cells early on. And I haven't got slides on that for this talk, but we can, I can answer questions about that later. And the other thing I probably didn't mention either is that we do use the styrofoam pushed into the end, so that each end of this row will have the 2 inches of styrofoam on it. And then these units are ready to sell the first week of May. Okay, let's go the right direction. So here we are. This is what used to happen. This would be kind of late April and or mid-April, and some years like the 1 year the apricots in southern Okanagan flowered the last week of March. I mean, that was one heck of a warm year. These bees, they're coming out. They're in between the nukes, even as tight as we got them. They're just big. They needed to be split. So we would go in and we call brood out of this, right? But that was very inefficient for time, very, very inefficient. So as soon as we figured out about this, you know, Michael Palmer, take that bottom off your box and give yourself a lot more flexibility. Well, then instead, we just add a second box now when those guys were just rocking away and needed a little more room. And so how we do it is, I guess I could go into this now a bit, and then I'll show you a diagrammatic that maybe help explain it as well a bit later. Is so about, believe it or not, the first about 8th of April, 9th, 10th, somewhere in there, normal year, we'll add the second box because we'll have hopefully six frames of bees ready to do something, ready to burst. So we'll add these up and put them on about then. And then, and so this is kind of, you know, this is what a chunky one would look like. I think we looked at this picture before, and I just wanted to make sure you knew that, you know, it, not all of them would be this grossly beat up, but for sure this one needs a second box, right? And so how we work these is, if this is a little diagrammatic, and this is an illustration of how we're nuking the nukes. Okay, so, I've taken this from another talk, and obviously the little pointer is on its way before I even start talking. But anyway, we'll use my little pointer here if I can find it again. Okay, we got to go back here. Okay, so here it is. Okay, so this is your unit that you've wintered, right? And as I'm saying, about the first week of April, you're going to add a second box to it. And then to answer your question about, do we use queen cells or queens, early on, this is going to be pretty early to have a queen available that we have made ourselves. So we'll just put a queen cell in the split. So we're going to sell this unit, you know, about the first week, our first orders that go out to the prairies are usually the first week of May. And so, and that's a sold unit. And then everything that didn't go in that unit will go ahead and be made into more nukes. And this is about the same time that we'll go through our hives, and we'll see that those hives are needing to be called, you know, some brood and bees need to be called. And so they will also go toward making more nukes here. And we'll add queen cells to those. And then by late May, early June, we'll have that queen working for us and frames of eggs and larvae in there. And so we'll sell it. So we've taken one nuke that we've wintered, and we've been able to sell two nukes out of it. That's the calculation we use. So it depends on how well you winter. And I was just bragging to the folks earlier that if you tick all the boxes using this system for us, so you've made sure they're good weight, that you don't have disease, that they have a queen, that you've treated them fully, typically we'll have less than 2% winter loss, up to 5 to 6% winter loss on these babies. So we can pretty well make sure, because some of them are wintering as two, that we'll be able to have two units sold out of each one of these that have wintered successfully. And then when you go to sell this one, you'll still have some brood extra, because we'll double up this one as well. And so we'll get more nukes out of this one. But now we'll start adding queens, because now we'll have queens available from our mating nukes, and that'll make everything go faster, right? And so then we've added a queen, and then what's the timing on this? So this would be probably late June. We would have this nuke from the other nukes that we've already sold, and it would be ready to split. And so now we're going to split it, and we're going to add queens to it. And this is going to be maybe the first week, end of June, early July. So now we've got that number. And then you can split them again if you want. But quite often, I'll just run these for honey instead, or just let them get chunky. And this is where, you know, maybe I let some of them get too high, and then I don't split them back, and maybe I should. But what I do want to say, though, is when you do these splits, you have to be much more careful about what you're going to do with these nukes. You're going to have to make sure that they're going to be able to build a good brood nest to winter, you know, those young bees that you haven't made them too small, right? They've got to be nice big splits, at least two frames of brood. And maybe we should go into a little bit of, when you're making a split, what does that mean? When you're nuking your nukes, like what are you putting in that box, right? Typically, I like to put two frames of brood or one half at a minimum. And I'd like to have one that's capped and one that's open. So now there's a continuum of brood that's going to hatch and be able to feed larvae and the queen. And as the queen develops, you've got all that working for you. Okay. So potentially you can take this little wintered nuke, sell two more and make two more. So you've got four to five nukes out of your one wintered nuke, which is, that's pretty nice, right? Anyway, I hope I've sold you on the idea of nuking the nukes. So there you go. Now you've got some extra income. These are some that we sold. When did we sell these? Well, it looks like, yeah, the end of May, first part of June, we took these up north there and sold them. And what we usually promise, these are four frame nukes that we sell here, that we have three frames of brood, and we feel that they're a much better deal than a package for a lot of reasons. So let's go into a little bit about wintering these nukes and then what you might do in the spring. So there's a large variety of ways and types of nukes that you can use, and you want to be sure of location factors with smaller units, right? So you can use the styrofoam ones, and these are the ones that I think Dave Taggart has developed. And he uses a feeding system that he just takes his feed and opens the valve and lets the syrup run into the bottom of the box. And then the bees feed on the syrup that's run to the bottom. And it's a timed thing, and that seems to work well for him. I borrowed a couple of these nuke boxes. Decided I didn't like them as well as my wood for a lot of reasons. First of all, they're plastic. I like to have my entrances at the bottom. So if there is any debris or chalk brood or something, they can get that out really easily. I like to be able to have a larger entrance at times. I prefer to feed with the boardman feeder so I can see how they're taking down their feed, when, where, why, because you can learn a lot from that. There's various things, but there's a lot of other nuke boxes out there now. And actually I just listened to the Kentucky Queen Breeders Association put on a talk about styrofoam nukes, and two or three different people gave talks, and they gave the pros and the cons that each one thought about all the different types of styrofoam nukes. And if you're interested in a talk like that, we could ask those speakers to come up and maybe give a talk on that for you guys. And so this is a fellow that winters bees. He would buy queens from me in October. And he would take his hives that he'd taken up to the fireweed and divide them out and put a queen in, and then winter them in these six frame boxes. And they did really well for him. He put them in a little shed. I don't think it was heated. And he would feed them or have feed or syrup available to them at all times with a little bottle with the, I guess, holes punctured in the lid, and then there's styrofoam all around, and then they'd have an entrance to the outside. And you can see he had just great results, and really that worked a good system for him. These are some of the frames that were in that nuke. And so that just gives you a small idea of all the different kinds of nukes that are out there, and not maybe that good of, you know, there's a lot more than what I've explained there. But I think the other thing to think about is, of course, your yards for these nukes. And just the last couple of weeks are probably the most ideal time to find good yards, because that's when your snow is melting. And so you can begin to see, okay, this is a slope facing south. It's going to have great air drainage. If I stick my nukes yard in here, they're going to be probably really toasty warm compared to being out here, right? So this is maybe one way to think about looking for nuke yards. And wind is fairly important in our minds, especially in a year that's going to have high winds with minus 20 temperatures. Because the way we wrap ours, they're not that heavily insulated around the perimeters, right? So we take extra care of it with our wind and our wind fences. Just lately, we've been using this shade cloth that they used to use for the ginseng, I think. And it was going really cheap. And we just put it on some small upright posts and stapled it on and put some 2x4s to support it on the inside and various supports for the wall itself. And then inside that, we'd have our nukes lined up. And here, we didn't use that sort of fencing material, shade cloth. These are just bins set on top each other. And that was to the north, and that would break the wind that way. And we'll see this spring. This is one that we built last fall. And we'll have an idea maybe this spring versus some of the other sites that don't have this windbreak to see if it really made a big difference. It certainly did in terms of winter loss. This yard virtually had no winter losses in it. So now we can have a quick look. How's our time going? Oh, we're over. So we'll have a real quick look at our spring management.
just because we started late, I think we're still a little bit okay. So,
okay. Yeah. Well, I don't want to. Yeah. I didn't expect to talk this long already. I'm just such a talker. Okay. So, spring management. So, one of the things you want to think about is assessing your nukes for size. As we talked about earlier, the amount of patty you put it on is how many bees you've got there. So, if we look at these and we just want to, what we usually go in. As we're padding and we mark on the styro or the box, you know, 3, 4, 5, you know, just what size is our cluster there? And so if we were to look at this box, let's see, this one here, this one is kind of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, maybe 5 frames of bees, but they're only halfway along, right? So I'd probably call that a 3. And then this one, I'd call that maybe a 4, 3.5, 4. And this would be a 4, 4.5, and that would be a 5. And so we kind of go through, and now we have an idea of size. And if we say we have a 2 or something like that, well, now we know we can go to our 5s and our 4s and 4. It just depends on the of course, the temperature that you're looking at it. And some years, one year, we were in a very large time constraint. I was in Japan, and Terry was leaving to go to England. And it was minus 10 and just not whether you would go in and do a pollen patty, but it was like late and we knew we had to do this before everybody left. So he went in and put the pollen patty on, I think it was March 7th, which is quite late for us in the Okanagan, South Okanagan. And it worked out perfectly. But he'll go in and because we have this plastic, right, you can pull it back and then put it on very, very quickly. And if you do it nicely and you haven't let them build up any of this comb, like these boxes are old boxes. So they've got a pretty big rim here and they've been able to build up a lot of comb. But now we have it so there's less space in the top above the frames. And so you can just about pull back that plastic, put on the pad. So we always have the patty ready before we open anything so that there's the least amount of time that you've opened and disturbed those bees. Okay, so that's talking about patty and sizing and all that good stuff. Okay, and so this is just an illustration of when we opened it up, this would be a 5. And of course we've prepped our patty ready to put it on. And you can see it's pretty thick. It's nearly double as thick as the global patty. And we will take the wax off. We'll use a smoker and bring that wax off before we put the patty on. And then after you've pattied, so this is after the first patty, what your nukes might look like and what they're telling you, right? So these guys have virtually eaten all their patty. There's a little bit of paper left there. But when you get down to this guy, he's still got some patty left. Now some hives will just not need Patty. They won't eat it and they'll do just fine. But quite often when you see a nuke that has especially a large amount of Patty, you're looking at trouble. And so you want to go into those. And so it's a very quick way to differentiate nukes that are just rolling along quite nicely and those that you better have a look at. So that's just one pointer on that. I guess we're going to leave it there. So this is just a suggestion that we did have a field day where we looked for drone congregation areas. It was a lot of fun. And it might be something that your club might want to put on one time. And we all you do is you just get some of those party balloons from the dollar store. And then you get a virgin from your local queen producer, or one of your guys that rears virgins, and put her in a cage and tie it to them. And then have a fishing rod so that she's attached and you can let it up and go up as high as you want. And then you can find, like, here we found two of our drone congregation areas. This is Kettle River. And these are all the little farms, little 5 and 10 acre farms. And this is where we just happened to find two of them. Anyway, open for any other questions. And thank you.
Thanks, Liz. That was very informative. It's going to just push me over the edge to do nukes this spring or this fall.
Great.
I do have a couple of questions there, Liz, if you don't mind. I didn't catch earlier, how do you treat mites with a nuke, for the nuke? I know formic acid sometimes can be kind of volatile for small hives.
That's a very good question. I didn't cover that at all, and you're right. So I would say that for myself, I no longer use Apivar. We did in the past, but we're just finding that, first of all, it's not as efficient, shall we say. I mean, it's still killing mites, but just not at the same rate. And because we're using so much more new equipment, I just hate to have a strip in there. Like, if I can use an organic treatment, that's the direction I'm going to go. So myself, and we were talking about this maybe before that I gave the talk, and that is, I'm okay with losing higher numbers. I kind of want to call the bees that are going to let that burrow grow. So I just use little night wipes. So these are the little pads. Sorry, is there somebody there that has another question or no? Anyway, so there, you just go to the grocery store and you can buy like 1,000 in a box that they use for putting underneath the steaks and things. And so I just use those and I put them at the back. I'll wet them up and then I'll have, a 3 kg bucket of honey. I'll just take that and I'll cut one of my queen excluders, my plastic queen excluders. And so it'll be around. And then I'll put something underneath it so it no longer sits on the bottom of that bucket. And then I'll pull over those little, and I'll use plastic tongs, just salad tongs or something. And I'll pick up those mite wipes and put them into that bucket so that they're now going to drain completely. So they won't be dripping at all. You want to have a dripping pad that you put on anything. And then I'll just put one of those on and you probably should do it every 5 to 7 days for a series of 4 to 5 treatments. So that's a lot of work. And it works pretty well. But if you want to have losses as low as my daughter, who had under 2% for years running, you probably want to do a little bit more than that. And so she'll go in October, I believe it was, and we should probably check with her to make sure I'm telling you the right thing. And they have one of those propane vaporizers now. So it's extremely quick, like seconds to treat a nuke. I think in 3 hours, half a day, I think she was saying, they treated 300 nukes. That's just unbelievably quick. And so they'll go through and she'll do that 4 or 5 times in that fall, November period. But I think it's mainly October though, that she did that. And so she's knocked those mites down to virtually zero. Okay, and then the last thing is using Bill Rosica's pads. And you can definitely use those if you have a too high 5-frame nuke in the top box and just stick it in if you want. And then you don't have as many like we were also discussing somebody, I think it was Ed, used those, but because he used them when it was warmer and they evaporated faster than they're supposed to. So you want to watch that because they're a long-term evaporative, slow evaporative treatment. And if the temperatures are wrong you have to be a little careful with those, let's say. Okay.
I think Bryce had his hand up there, so he can unmute there if he has some questions or something to say.
Can you hear me okay?
Oh, yeah?
Yep. Yeah. We just had a question whether or not there was any concern around ventilation.
Right. Okay. This is another topic I didn't cover. Okay. So there's always the question about top entrances or not, and what you want to do there. And what we find is that in those nuke boxes, you probably are all familiar with anti-Antarctic's website, right? Nod your head yes, right? Okay, good, yeah. All right, so you're all familiar with his work and the fact that he doesn't use a top entrance in the Yukon. And that's because he's ticked the boxes that he sized his cluster to the area that they're in. So with that 5-frame nuke box, you can easily have a cluster that's just perfect for that size box, right? So you've sized your cluster to the box. One, that's one box you've ticked. You've ticked the box that you fed it well enough, you've treated it well enough. And what other boxes did you have to have? The sizing, and then the insulation. So then you had to make sure, he suggests, that your insulation is such that you're not going to have a very tight cluster. There's enough insulatory capacity in what you're using that they aren't going to shrink way down. Well, in these 5-frame nukes, they don't have far to shrink, one. And two, from the temperature surveys I've done with my T2 sensors, and I should go back because I don't remember numbers very well, but I believe at no time did they go below 10 degrees centigrade when the center was above on the top bars of those nukes. But I would want to check that before I totally state that as being truth. And just recently I downloaded, And so I'm part of, and probably quite a few of you are as well, part of the project where we're looking at, I know your members are, part of that project where it's a broodminder project for all across the province, right? And so I download my data to that and you can see it. And I'll have it listed as like nukes 1 to 10 or something. I've actually got probably over 20 data loggers out there now. I'm a little nuts. I'm looking at different types of wraps, even in that foil. Anyway, we're looking at other things. Did I answer the question? I hope so. One entrance. Yeah, the bottom line there was have one entrance. You do not need any other entrance. And what's really cool about that plastic, I don't think I mentioned this, is starting about now, even our hives, we'll make sure, because our hives are not insulated hardly at all. They just have a little bit of tar paper on them and a very thin little pillow because we want to make sure that we're having bees that can withstand winters for us, because we're going to sell a lot of this stuff out to the prairies where it's much colder. And so we have to know our bees can take winter. Any case, so we'll have a top entrance in a lot of those hives because we haven't ticked all the boxes, right? But even then, right now, we'll make sure that plastic is completely over. As soon as you put that patty on, you want to preclude having a top entrance because now that brood needs to be moist and warm, right? And to do that, if you've got that vapor barrier that allows them to retain, especially in our dry climates, that to us, it was a real eye opener. We learned that from a a fellow that came down to buy nukes from the north, from the Peace, and he used those plastics, and we started using it. That was like 30 years ago or something, and we just latched onto that. Anyway, one entrance, if you tick the boxes.
No, I just have one question for you. Now, you showed those beautiful frames with the swarm cells and all that. Do you utilize any of those swarm cells, or do you just graft? I'm just wondering if your queen production.
Okay. Well, I would totally suggest myself, I would graft. So one of the experiments I've done is I did run for about 7 years. I ran a yard with no treatment, right? And it was quite isolated, very far away. And I would get there just before I thought they would be swarming. So I could, believe it or not, I could do my divides and stuff. And sometimes I would hit it right on the nose because the virgins were just hatching. And so I would gather up those virgins. And if you could see the variety of virgins that come out of even swarm cells, they're good ones and there's not so good ones, you know? And of course you're breeding for swarming if you're collecting and doing that early. So there's a couple of downsides to that. And I certainly wouldn't, I would try not to use a queen cell made when it was an emergency situation. Okay.
Thank you. Anyone else have any questions?
Okay. Is that Joe in the front seat there, Joe Lomond? Oh, ho. And Mr. Nuke already. He could probably add a few things here.
Yes, later.
Meeting's been a meeting.
Liz.
You're welcome.
Do you want to go ahead and thank you?
Oh, thank you.
Can you hear me?
Oh, she can hear you.
Yeah. Thank you for your time. Sorry about the front end. We're a little clumsy.
Oh, that's okay. Yeah, there's a lot to learn about all these Zoom things. And I would suggest if you haven't seen it and didn't know about it, that the BCB breeders, we've just put on a series, an educational series. And it talks about a lot of breeding stuff. And maybe it's not something you want to know right now, but it's just another resource if you want. And we're going to be posting as well a web page in a few days with all the very really cool articles that are coming out now, 2020, 21, 22 on research that might be pertinent that you'd be interested in as well. Yeah. Thank you. And hope you all wintered well or can make 1,000 nukes and be selling to each other next spring.
We wish.
Probably the best year we've ever had.
What was that? Sorry?
Probably the best year we've ever had.
Oh, for wintering?
Yes.
Says Joe.
Okay. Oh, good. Well, yeah, I heard from some other people that it was probably one of the worst years.
Yes, I've heard that too.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Good luck, Sam, to your honey for us.
Okay, will do. The better half. Okay.
Yeah, better half. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Take care.
Okay. Yeah, we've known her for 34 years.
I think she's gone.
Yeah. New box.